I would like to introduce Dr. Neslihan Ekmekçioğlu and the chairperson, Associate Professor Dr. Nazan Tutaş.
Thank you very much. Distinguished guests, I am pleased to present another distinguished Shakespeare scholar, Dr. Neslihan Ekmekçioğlu. Once again, I say once again because I chaired her session in Beckett Conference as well. Thank you for inviting me again. After a ballet, Shakespeare's ballet, this time it's going to be her Shakespeare's songs, music. Before that, let me introduce her. Dr. Neslihan Ekmekçioğlu is a Shakespeare scholar, an art instructor, and a lecturer. She's also a musician, playing the piano and the cello. She has received her MA degree on James Joyce from Hacettepe University. The title of her thesis was The Concept of Time in James Joyce's work. She received her PhD degree on Shakespeare from Hacettepe University. Professor Dr. Engin Uzman was her supervisor on Shakespeare. The title of her thesis was The Theme of Ambition and the Implied Counterparts in Shakespeare's Plays. Since 1988, she visited London and Stratford-upon-Avon many times and attended the International Shakespeare Summer Course at the Shakespeare Institute. She has a member. She has been a member of the International Shakespeare Association since 2000. She is also a member of Société Française Shakespeare, European Shakespeare Research Association, and British Shakespeare Association. She participated in the 7th Shakespeare World Congress in Spain, Valencia, and 9th Shakespeare World Congress in Prague in 2011. She has been lecturing on Shakespeare and British drama at the Department of English Language and Literature at Hacettepe since 2003 as a part-time lecturer. She has also worked at the theatre department of the State Conservatory for many years. Her published essays are on Samuel Beckett, Peter Schaeffer, Falls, Lawrence, Murdoch, Sylvia Plath, Oscar Wilde, and Shakespeare. Most recently, she presented a paper on memory theater and postmodern aesthetics on the contemporary stage, Heiner Müller's Hamlet Machine, at Aristotle University, Thessaloniki. She participated in Shakespeare Conference in London and presented a paper on Shakespeare's Richard II. She participated in ESRA Conference, Shakespeare and Myth, at the University of Montpellier and presented a paper entitled Cleopatra as Goddess of Love, Venus, the most ambitious image of femininity in Shakespeare's Antonio and Cleopatra. And the title of her presentation today is The Use of Musical Imagery, the Dramatic Function of Music and Songs in Shakespeare.
Well, thank you very much. Also, I would like to thank my dear professor, the chief of the department, Professor Dr. Gülçin Erol. Thank you very much.
Well, in Shakespeare's poetry and plays, there are various musical references. You would like to have it?
Okay. You must come back over here. Sorry.
In Shakespeare's poetry and plays, there are various musical references and numerous allusions to music and the influence of music upon man's soul. They seem to reflect all aspects of the musical knowledge of his time as well as musical practice. Shakespeare's knowledge apparently seemed to cover the entire gamut of music, practical as well as theoretical, from the scale itself to the more sophisticated ideas on the subject, such as the notion of the music of the spheres, which comes from Plato and Pythagoras, and the power of music to sway men's psyche, to affect human emotions, and to cure by its purifying magical divine effect, which comes from the works of Ficino and Pico della Mirandola. In the Renaissance, under the influence of the enigmatic text of Hermes Trismegistus. The mystery concerning how Shakespeare knew all this about music, whether intuitively or consciously, lies unanswered as a dark zone, thank you very much, where Shakespearean scholars attempt to pluck out the heart of that musical mystery. The historical accounts of Whitelock reflect that at Westminster and Shrewsbury, Richard Mulcaster showed great care and enthusiasm for teaching music at the Merchant Taylors' School. But what about the grammar school at Stratford-upon-Avon? How and where did Shakespeare learn so much about music? Was Shakespeare schooled as a choir boy, or did he study music privately? It has been suggested that Shakespeare might have picked up most of his information about music from musical acquaintances, from hearing music played in the taverns, private houses, the court, the church, and bawdy houses. The academic world remains still largely in silence and darkness about the musical people who could be associated with Shakespeare. High on top of the list was Tom Smalley. What was the relationship between the poet and the musician? Did they collaborate on the songs such as "Oh, Mistress Mine," or "It Was a Lover and His Lass" in Twelfth Night, or were both tunes most popular before being taken up on stage by Shakespeare? Then there was another creative artist in Shakespeare's theatre, his wise fool, Robert Armin, who was both a musician and a poet-philosopher himself. Armin was known for his beautiful voice in his time, might have written some of the songs in Twelfth Night. No doubt there were several other musical people around Shakespeare at the time, such as John Bull, who was a composer and virtuoso performer, Giles Farnaby, who was the famous composer of the madrigals of the time, John Daniel, who was Samuel's musical brother, and most importantly, John Dowland, the royal lutenist of the time. Another musical mystery among the acquaintances of Shakespeare could be named as the she, who could be paralleled in a way Beethoven's immortal Billaud, a lady who was never identified except given in fragments, but known as the Dark Lady of the Sonnets. In Sonnet 128, Shakespeare describes the figure of the lady playing a musical instrument. "How oft when thou my music playest, upon that blessed wood whose motion sounds with thy sweet fingers, when thou gently swayest the wiry concord that mine ear confounds, do I envy those jacks that nimble leap to kiss the tender inward of thy hand, over whom thy fingers walk with gentle gait, making dead wood more blessed than living lips." As Shakespeare depicts the lady cupping her hand over the striking mechanism of a wooden instrument, which can be either a lute or virginal in order to tune it, the sonnet turns into an erotic love poem where music as well as the billaud appearing as a musician are intensively adored. The poet even becomes jealous of the strings of the instrument because of the lady's tenderness and closeness of them. According to A. Rose, who wrote Shakespeare's biography, Amelia Lenier could have been the Dark Lady of the Sonnets. Amelia was coming from an Italian family of musicians. Her father, Baptista Bassano, was a Venice-born musician of Jewish origin at the court of Elizabeth I. Amelia became the mistress of Henry Carey, Lord Hunsdon, who was Elizabeth's half-brother and also Lord Chamberlain, the patron of the arts and theatre. Amelia's interest in astrology could be seen in Simon Forman's diaries, as she often visited the physician and astrologer of the time. When Lenier became pregnant with Henry Carey's child, she was forced to marry Alfonso Lenier, a musician at the court of Elizabeth I. David Lasocki and Roger Pryor, in their work entitled The Bassanos, Venetian Musicians and Instrument Makers in England between 1531-1665, also accept and fortify Rose's suggestion about the identity of the Dark Lady being Amelia Lenier. In Titus Andronicus, Shakespeare describes the injustice and cruelty done to a flute player in the figure of the raped and mutilated Lavinia. As Marcus recognizes the terrible appearance of Lavinia with her hands and tongue cut, with the blood dropping from her mouth and hands, reveals the past, the beauty of Lavinia's musically talented fingers playing the lute in the past. Oh, had the monster seen those lily hands tremble like aspen leaves upon a lute and make the silken strings delight to kiss them, he would not then have touched them for his life. Or had he heard the heavenly harmony which that sweet tongue hath made, he would have dropped his knife and fell asleep as Cerberus at the Thracian poet's feet, unquote. Shakespeare uses the musical imagery of Orpheus, who went to the underworld to see Eurydice, and in order to enter the underworld, he bewitched the guardian dog Cerberus with his musical instrument. In The Two Gentlemen of Verona, the imagery concerning Orpheus and his magical music is also referred. Proteus says, "For Orpheus's lute was strung with poet's sinews, whose golden touch could soften steel and stones make tigers tame," unquote. Orpheus and the tuning of the inner and outer man played many roles for the Neoplatonists of the Renaissance. Orpheus was a passionate lover who was cruelly separated from the beautiful woman he adored, as Petrarch was separated from Laura. His music and poetry celebrate both the beauty of his beloved and his emotional grief at the loss of such beauty to death. Orpheus laments the shortness of life and love and the ephemeral quality of the sensory pleasure. Orpheus's song consists of 11 verses, each ending with the Virgilian refrain, which was so dear to Neoplatonists, "Quod amor vincit omnia," love conquers all. His second role was that of the civilizer who softens the hearts of primitive people. Orpheus could make the wild beast tame with his lyre, make rocks and woods move, and hold streams in their courses. John Warden tells that Orpheus is the teacher of humanitas, which is defined by Ficino as the capacity for love. Orpheus was also the artist who looked within himself to discover the harmony of the cosmos, and by his art and music leads others to a better understanding of the beyond. Orpheus was the one who taught Plato and Pythagoras the Orphic mysteries. As a poet, Orpheus sings the creation of the world, of how love came into being out of chaos, and of the essential unity and singleness of the cosmos. The Orphic lyre, with its 7 strings, represents the 7 known planets and stands for the symbol of cosmic harmony. Since mathematically the intervals of the Orphic lyre are the structured basis of the entire visible universe and of the human soul.